have on our panel two distinguished physicians who are in the leadership position in our community with here with us and help us with the discussion. Our first guest is Dr. Christopher Chow. Good evening. How are you, Dr. Chow?
Fine. How are you?
Welcome to our show. I'm glad you can make it here.
Thank you.
Dr. Chow is physician in chief at the Santa Clara Kaiser Permanente of course, in Santa Clara, I say that. And our second guest is Dr. George Ting. Dr. Ting was chief of staff at El Camino Hospital in Mountain View last year. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here with us. We also have a live audience consisting of physicians, nurse practitioners, and some patients. Welcome to our show. Thank you for being here. So let's start with Dr. Chow first, huh? Dr. Chow, who would be the ideal physician at Kaiser?
I don't think the ideal physician is any different from what you've characterized as Dr. Welby. I think we're still looking for those qualities of sensitivity, a highly trained, qualified person. As far as the individual patient is concerned, I think that's still the ideal physician. I think, though, when you speak about the term in a more generically, in this world, in our environment, the ideal physician perhaps has more responsibilities than encompassed by both quality and service, but also has to be concerned about societal issues like cost.
That's right.
And so when you say to me, what is the ideal physician, I think it's someone who is able to balance, to me, the three primary factors that determine good medical care, is to balance the ability between quality and service and cost, which perhaps is not a responsibility that the medical profession or physicians have had to cope with in the past.
Yeah. Dr. Ting, who is the ideal physician in a private practice setting?
Well, I'm glad you had Dr. Chow go first. It gave me a few minutes to think about my response. In a lot of ways, I think the ideal physician is defined by that one-to-one contact he or she has with the patient. I think there are a lot of good physicians who are in research or in teaching, mm-hmm. but for the purposes of my answer, I like to address the clinician. And I think it goes without saying that competence needs to be there, that the physician needs to know what he or she needs to know and have the skills to do what needs to be done. But starting from that baseline, I think beyond that, you know, if Marcus Welby was good for any particular reason, it was the degree of concern and compassion he had for his patients. And no matter how good a physician you are, if you don't have that and if you can't demonstrate that, that interaction with a patient won't be satisfactory. When we talk about bedside manner, in some ways it's an important part of being a physician, and in some ways there are a lot of very high-powered physicians who would think it's not that important, it's sort of an accoutrement. Mm-hmm. But I in fact think that that time you spend with a patient and the confidence you can bring to mm-hmm. that patient is a very important part of the healing process. Mm-hmm. Maybe in the most extreme case, you know, people go to physicians for all sorts of things, from bad splinters to, you know, some minor things. But if you think about the maybe one of the more difficult situations you can be in, where you're going with fear or loss of hope for your life or your loved one, the ability for that physician to really hear you, show concern, be able to do some things before any tests are done or laying on of hands, the ability to transmit some confidence starts the healing process right there. Mm-hmm. So I think there are all these nebulous things as well as the very important concrete things that Dr. Yeah. Chow has mentioned.
Yeah, I'm certainly very pleased. I'm very happy to hear from both of you that the compassionate quality and the time you spend with a patient is so important in defining the the ideal or the physician that we'd like to go to, because that is one of the area of concern that I have heard from a lot of patients and other people, laymen, expressing, is that they don't feel that the physicians have time with them. Practice medicine has become very technical, isn't it? Very technological, and we have great technology. But without the, I would like to think of medicine as much as an art, as a science. And that's the beauty of medicine, really. You're dealing with human beings, and it's not like mathematics. You know, one is two. I mean, you know, one of the things that strikes me about the atmosphere of difficulty that physicians have to operate nowadays is the cost issue. And yet, you know, I mean, medical service is not like a hamburger. You know, a hamburger, you can replace it. You know, if a patient come in and he's not happy, he can have another one. But how do we go about giving another service when a patient is not happy? That's not as easy as we think. From my own standpoint, I'd like to be fair here, you know, to be fair game. I'd like to, because I have been thinking about this topic more, I'd like to volunteer to define my own image of the ideal physician for me. And maybe after that, I can ask one of you in the audience to contribute. For me, my ideal physician would be the physician who combines the compassionate quality of a good family physician who knows me as a person and who's interested in me. And then he would have the diagnostic skill of a good internist, so that not only he has the compassion, the human quality, but he knows how to diagnose an ailment if I have symptoms of one. And then he would also have the technical capability of a good surgeon, so that if I need surgery, he would help me with the best kind of technical operation. And of course, you can go on and on saying that, you know, he has to be cost efficient, blah, 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 and all those things, you know, to comply with what the society is demanding of the physician. But when I think of that, it's very difficult, isn't it, to have all those things in one physician. So I think of that more as a team of those physicians, which we can really have, isn't it? We can have the we call it the primary care, the gatekeeper, who spend a lot of time with prevention and education and being the coach. And then he can have the resources he goes to, or he can send the patients to the specialists who can give the kind of care, specialized care that the patient needs. So that's my own definition of my ideal physician, which is really a team of three physicians there. Do I have a volunteer here from one of you who would like to tell me what you think would be the physician that you would like to go to when you get sick? Any one of you? Mr. Klein?
I'm tempted to say that if you... Am I supposed to stand up? I'm tempted to say that if you have a wafy patient who wants to be ministered to as a mother or a father would, you're in deep trouble. I don't know that you can... you have to have a certain amount of self-reliance in the patient, no matter how ill the patient may be. There's only some things a doctor can do with his knowledge. One thing he cannot do is go back into your childhood. I don't know if I'm expressing myself adequately, but
we're
I think
about the ideal physician here. Who would be the ideal physician for you?
A logical person who knows where to find what has to be done and can explain it to me. That's all I ask of him.
But I'm afraid a lot of time we don't have the answers for certain medical questions, though. That's where the problem is.
That's part of the gamble of living. You accepted it when you drew your first breath.
Okay.
That's all.
What are the three major qualities of a physician that you would look for when you choose yours?
I've had a number of physicians in my life in different parts of the world. And all I really ever asked is that it be logical, that they know what they were saying, that's all. And I didn't expect too much magic. There were times when I felt pretty hopeless.
So if he tells you that he doesn't know what to do, or he doesn't know the answers,
I would appreciate his honesty.
Okay. So you're not demand of him of knowing everything?
I might feel a little put out that he didn't have the answer, but I would accept the fact that he didn't.
Okay. I'm glad you say that. It's because I have been practicing in this country for 23 years now. And I went to school in France, and before that I was educated in Vietnam. And in my experience, especially in primary care, there are many medical issues that do not have a medical answer. A lot of them are influenced by socioeconomic factors. A lot of them are psychological, economics, sometimes political. That's why I'm afraid that if we don't look at medicine as a global field that is complex, and yet there are many intricacies in it. To me, that's the beauty of medicine that I like, and that's why I enjoy being a physician, is that oftentimes we don't have clear answers, but if we care enough about the patients, we may find a way to alleviate his pain without having the absolute product that he may want. You have something to say?
Mr. Klein, I think he exemplifies for me that when you try to generalize mm-hmm. what you want in an ideal physician, it is quite different from person to person.
Right.
And what Mr. Klein is expressing, that he wants to have somebody he has confidence in, he has trust in, that's going to be able to deliver to him what he wishes. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what a ideal physician is, who's able to treat each individual and give to that individual what that individual is asking of him. And if mm-hmm. you have a relationship where confidence and trust is engendered, I think yeah. you've accomplished what you need to accomplish aside from your clinical competency.
Yeah.
To generalize and say everybody should be a certain way, I think it begs the question a little bit. I think there are basic human qualities are what you need, and then you need the medical knowledge on top of that.
You were going to say something?
Well, my response to these issues that have been raised really is sort of, it's like what someone said about what life is. It's how you spend your time. And it does come down to time. If someone's taking out a splinter or taking something out of your eye, you just want them to do it. But a good physician should know, when do you need to do more? You need to be able to slow down the process and understand that there are beliefs or fears or emotions or background that's very important to treating the patient. And at times you need to really slow down, because you can't treat the patient without knowing that. Mm-hmm. And part of being able to do that is to be very clear about what you do have to offer. You know, you can't mother or father someone. But many, if not most times, we are limited by what we can offer a patient. Mm-hmm. And it's just as important to be able to say in an honest way, these are some of the options. These are the pros and cons of this versus this, and sort of help them understand it. And then be understanding enough of where the patient's coming from to be able to help them make that choice. Mm-hmm. So taking the time to do that properly and being able to have the answers when you have them and be mm-hmm. able to say, we don't have the answers, but here are the choices. If you can do that ably, you can help the patient accept the choices. Mm-hmm. There's only these choices, and you can help them accept them. And part of the therapeutic process is for the patient to say, I'm satisfied that what can be done is offered and that I can accept one of these things with comfort and confidence. And that's really a part of what a physician has to do.
Well, the problem I see here, Dr. Ting, is that in my experience, one of the main difficulty that I have had, or the other physicians I have observed have, is that the patients cannot accept you not knowing something. The average patient expects you to have the answers, sometimes the quick answers even. You know, I mean, you may be a ideal patient because you don't expect that from us. But a lot of patients, they come in, they have a problem, they want an answer, and then they have a quick solution. And that is when I don't think that is a realistic expectation. What do you think? Is that your feelings also, or?
My views of an ideal physician is, first of all, a physician that is well-trained in the medical profession, well-trained and competent to start with. And then this has to be enhanced with compassion, and above all, have a good communication with the patient. In other words, in everything in life, you have to have a communication with, you know, with the human being in order to survive. And you have to portray confidence in the patient, which you're not only with your competence, but also with your compassion and your way or your approach toward the particular incident, particular, you know, sick illness that he has and his particular status of mind. And I think this, the communication with the patient is of utmost importance.
Okay, I agree with that. Yeah, I think you touched on a very important issue there. That is the communicative skills. Do you think that we as physicians are truly capable in communicating well with our patients the way we are trained?
Inherently?
Yeah.
I think, by and large, you know, in our training, it's interesting to reflect back on your training. Basically, most of the time, all you're doing in your training is communicating and talking, and you learn didactically speaking to each other. I think physicians are no different than anybody else. There's a spectrum of ability to communicate, but our profession is so much dependent upon that, that by and large, the selection process does pick out people who basically have that capability. But it varies with each individual as to how good or bad they are able to communicate. I think they're good and they're bad. And they're, but the majority of physicians, that's their bread and butter. Without being able to communicate, they couldn't practice their profession.
I certainly agree with that. And as a matter of fact, to get back to this ideal or good physician, communication is a two-way street. And the first part of communication is listening and understanding and getting the bigger picture of who the patient is. And once you get that, and once you know what you know, being able to bring the patient here or bring what you need over there, that is communication. And that's the heart of the therapeutic process. A lot of times, you know, what can you do for certain things? You can certainly offer some comfort and confidence. To get back to your other question, Dr. Vu, about they expect you to know more or me to know more, it may depend on the specialty. Being a subspecialist, I'm usually at the end of the line, and as often, I have the predicament of trying to deal with a patient and not do everything that can be done. Mm-hmm. And again, so to me, taking care of the patient isn't doing everything that can be done, but is getting to treat the patient as you get to understand them, what is right for them. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that means, that's not withholding treatment, excuse me, I think that means explaining what the options are and then guiding them to what the right treatment is. Mm-hmm. And yes, there are certainly some times when I say, this is an unknown area, and we could take out every bit of tissue and do all the tests and do a lot of scans and send you to second and third and fourth opinions, and we won't, you'll get a lot of opinions, but there's no other dogma that you need to know. And by, I can't really recall a patient I've had that has said, that's grossly inadequate, I'm going to go somewhere else. And I think if you can say it honestly and sort of put different sides to it, that patients understand that and they want to know what's right for them. Mm-hmm. And they don't expect something that's not available. So I guess it does start off that I have the confidence that what I'm telling them, I'm aware of what is available. But even when I'm aware that there's some extreme treatment that they might want to consider, my role isn't to say, let's go do this. It may be this is the right thing for you or your mother or your grandmother. And although you even may want us to do these other things, let's try to understand what the right thing is. And that, and again, that takes time. That takes understanding, that takes communication. Most of all, it takes the time to be able to do that.
What I'm trying to get at, Dr. Ting, is that to gain the trust of a patient is really a very important factor in the quality of medical care. And yet, you know, how to gain that trust can be very difficult because the pressure of time, we don't have time to spend with the patient. Nowadays, we're pushing toward the big health maintenance organization. And there will be a time we have to sacrifice some of the quality of time because, you know, we have to produce a certain quota, you know, of work. And not only that, I am afraid that in our traditional way of being trained, we have very good lecturers. And the model of medical training education is having people who are very eloquent research lecturers by being very bright in giving a lecture very well. But then when it comes to really coming one-on-one basis of the patient, it involves a bilateral kind of communication. You need to be able to listen. You need to be able to communicate by body language. And all those things come into play. And oftentimes, I have seen a lot of very well qualified in terms of credentials. They have the best credentials in terms of being the A student all through high school and medical school. And they don't know how to communicate with the patients. And when there are two kind of communication that the physician has to do every day to his patient and to his colleagues. And I have observed many, many times where that communication process is defective, which is the origin of many, many difficulties that we have within many different kind of places I have been to. So I'm glad that you mentioned communication because that is very key to any kind of quality medical care. Because even if you have a perfect technical capability, you still have to explain to the patient before you go into do the operation on the patient, isn't it? And to calm his fear, whatever. Because you don't know. I mean, you know, even the best surgeon cannot guarantee perfect results. Okay? So the patient cannot blindly go into the operating room thinking he's going to come out in one piece. So how he goes about getting to know the patient, calming his fear, and then go to the operation. And more importantly, if something goes wrong, how is he going to gain that trust back? Those are the things that I think that we have to look at very carefully because that is, I mean, in our country, really people expect perfection, isn't it? And a lot of time, there are babies who are born for no reason at all. You have some defect and the mother can sue the obstetrician. Because patients do want perfection here. We have to really be careful of that. And how to balance being honest to them, saying that we don't know the answer. We really are human beings. We make mistakes too. Can we say that? Can we safely say that? Maybe not. What do you think? We may be incriminating ourselves into a malpractice suit.
My observation has been is that very often you have difficulty with malpractice. And it comes back to communication. I envision, I have an experience, for instance, with a physician that I consider an ideal physician, and he's an oncologist. And inevitably, all of us face death, and that's the final outcome, and to us as physicians, that may represent failure. Mm-hmm. And yet all his patients, the eventual outcome for them is death. And I've observed his patients, they all approach death with equanimity, with confidence and trust that all that can be done is being done for them, and they're comfortable. As they're inevitably fail. And I think this represents a sensitivity and ability on the part of that physician to earn the confidence of that patient and aid that patient along the course of the illness, which very often we can't change. I think patients, when you approach them with that sensitivity, are very receptive to what it is you have to say to them, what you have to offer to them. Mm-hmm. That very often they will come in with an expectation of something, but as long as you're approaching them reasonably and rationally, accepting and understanding why they're asking for it, they will accept the alternative. Right. And then the fact is that it's not really indicated that they receive what they asked for. I think people are reasonable. Mm-hmm. If you treat them reasonably, they respond reasonably. Right. I find very few unreasonable people that you have to deal with. They're always them, but they're not many of them. The majority of people are reasonable. They're coming in asking for reasonable things. Malpractice, I think, very often is not because we made a mistake, but it's because we haven't been appropriate in our communicating with the patient and have not dealt appropriately with the patient. Right. The end result is some sort of action of that sort.
That's very true. Yeah, that's very true. The reason I'm mentioning this is because we are in a very difficult position oftentimes. And again, you know, one thing that I learned when I was at the University of Chicago that has been very helpful for me, And that is one of my teachers I remember very well. And he said that if you care enough, you know what to do for the patient. And it's so true, because you may get help from somebody else, you know, you may hone your abilities. If you really care, you know what to do. But if you don't care because of one reason or another, you know, some people are in the wrong field. You know, they may want to have the benefits of being a doctor, but they may not like it. A lot of physicians now are under a tremendous amount of pressure. And I personally have not seen too many physicians who really enjoy what they do anymore. For one reason or another. What do you think? You're shaking your head.
That's not been my experience.
Okay.
I think the majority of physicians go into medicine because they enjoy taking mm-hmm. care of people, and they take a great deal of pride in their work. Mm-hmm. I agree that there's a tremendous amount of pressure out there, mm-hmm. and the life for the physician is changing, and perhaps it isn't as comfortable as it used to be, mm-hmm. because there are a lot more external pressures being placed on physicians, and
yeah.
physicians don't have the freedom to function in the manner in which they've been accustomed in the past. But I dare say I find very few physicians leaving the field and changing their profession to do something else. Mm.
Well, you know, I just came across an article written by Dr. Gabbard. Dr. Gabbard is a psychiatrist who is in Kansas, and he specializes in issues having to do with the mental health of physicians. And he outlines that the typical, what do you call, the US-born male middle-aged physician is very prone to depression. In other words, he expects very highly of himself. He may really not enjoy what he does that much, but you know he has very high expectation of himself, and he has low self-esteem, matter of fact, and he seeks a lot of approval from both his patients and his colleagues, and that was very intriguing to me, because I have had that impression myself. Let's talk about another issue here, and that is the competitiveness in medicine. The reason I mentioned this is because that has been one of the difficulties I personally have found in the way we practice in this country, is that physicians are very highly competitive. It really is a boxing match to get into medical school. And then throughout the training, it's quite difficult. You know, you always have to give the impression that you work very hard, you're better, you know more. And then when you go into practice, the same situation continues, wherever it is. I have felt that there's more of a competition among physicians and cooperation. And yet, the best kind of medical care that I think that is delivered is through a teamwork, where physicians work as a team, helping each other out, and taking care of the patients. But my feeling is that it has been highly competitive, whether it's in private practice, HMO, or university. Physicians don't work together to take care of the patients. Is that your impression also, or you have a different experience?
I'm not sure I'd agree that competitiveness is the best word. I think independence is, and there is a selection process so that people who like to be independent tend to go into medicine. And I think that may account for some of the changes. The older guard, people who've been around for a long time, value that. Their expectation is to have autonomy, be able to do things the way they want to, and have some difficulty with some of the changes occurring in healthcare now. On the other hand, some of the newer, more recent graduates have the expectation that they're working within a system. And I think there's less dissatisfaction when that's your expectation. But you know, in terms of this independence, I know if I went to a physician, I would want that person to be someone who thought for himself and listened to me for who he was. I wouldn't want someone who sort of hooked onto every fad and changed his mind and wasn't conservative. I there's a lot to be said for the tried and true. So in that sense, the independence that's generated by the training process, the rigors of the training process. You don't want to go to a physician who, after working 8 hours, is tired and can't concentrate on you, and somehow at least traditionally, the thought of going through internship is that you get used to that and you know you can get through anything if you had to. So I guess I portray what you may see as competitiveness as an independence that in some ways desirable. I think, though, that really what's happening in healthcare now is a transition from the old traditional system, one which El Camino is most familiar with in many ways, which is solo, independent, private practice, mm-hmm. where physicians rate themselves, and then they rate themselves on how well they can work with their peers. Because in this day and age, no one person can do everything. You rely on peers and other specialists, and a lot of times we bail each other out. You become very dependent, and you can have a very good working relationship that way. But that's a very different arrangement from going to a much more managed care environment, such as Dr. Chow. They're the epitome of excellence in managed care. And it's a very different mindset then. And many times a patient who goes there, I think they have very satisfactory individual encounters. Mm-hmm. But some of the quality of the encounter is defined by the whole organization. Mm-hmm. It's like you're going to this place, the whole place has a good reputation for good medical care, and you know, you're going to be okay, as opposed to you seek out this one person who has this exceptional reputation. Mm-hmm. So there's that shift from this independence to a much more collaborative, managed care, cooperative way of delivering care.
I think you referred to the ideal physician as a Dr. Welby, but I think you have to understand that when Dr. Welby was held out as an example, that medicine was quite different then than it is now.
Sure.
And medicine has advanced so greatly, and technology has advanced, and our knowledge has advanced so greatly. It's very difficult for one physician to encompass the whole field of medicine anymore.
Right.
And I think that forces the medical field to become more interdependent, the people to relate and deal with each other, because you are mutually independent.
Right.
No one physician really can do all that medicine
exactly.
encompasses. And so I think these pressures cause that this is more of a collaborative kind of effort mm-hmm. On the parts of people rather than a single person totally responsible.
Mm-hmm.
I think by nature of our backgrounds and the rigors that we've gone through to become a physician, we are competitive. We believe in achievement. Mm-hmm. We believe in accomplishing. And so that gives you that kind of nature. But I think mm-hmm. The way medicine is now, that there's much less independence, much more mutual cooperativeness,
yeah.
much more working together, mm-hmm. and that the model of medicine in the future will encompass more and more of that.
Right. Because medicine is just such a broad field, you know, nobody can really know enough of anything anymore. So I would like to see that there will be more cooperativeness among physicians who get together and contribute what he knows in the team to the total care of the patient. I think that would be much better than the old model of trying to get good grades and show off that you know more, you have read more, you have done more. Because one of the things that disturbs me very much is that I have really met very few physicians, American physicians, who do not think that they haven't had the best training or haven't had the most experience. They think of themselves as truly believe that they are the best. And that's very dangerous, because sometimes you don't really reach out and get help. That's what I'm trying to say. Is that, you know, we need to get help when we get stuck. You know, that's what I'm trying to get at. And now, there's one question I'd like to ask Dr. Chow. I was hoping to have Dr. McGuire here, who would represent the university as an institution, but unfortunately, he could not be here tonight. The HMO is an institution, is a bit different from the private practice hospital or the university in that it is a large corporation, which is sort of a closed system in which the corporate officers really have very, very vast power. And really the individual physician has practically no chance of disagreeing with them or even much less challenging their authority. So is there any kind of an independent body whereby the individual physician can come and air his differences or his grievances in case he doesn't agree with the corporate officers and have a fair chance of being heard?
You're speaking about specifically our organization, yeah. The way we're structured?
Yeah.
We are a large corporation. We have over 3,000 physician shareholders in the corporation. Right. But everybody who is a corporate, quotes, corporate officer is really an elected person, a person that has to stand election and is selected by his or her peer to serve in the office in which they serve. Mm-hmm. So each of us does have responsibility, each one of our shareholders. Mm-hmm. Our philosophy is that for any organization to succeed, whether it's our organization or any other organization, the physicians really have to be all individual owners of that organization. They are the ones that are going to be the ones that are going to be instrumental as to whether that organization is going to work or not. So our point of view is that all our shareholders are owners, that I'm not their boss. I'm serving them to help them do their job. And we do have recourse within our organization. Should there be a dispute with me, we do have recourse for them to appeal up the ladder to get recourse.
Oh, I see.
So we're very concerned that we don't have individuals or physicians perceiving themselves to be a very small cog in the wheel that's not meaningful. That's not actually the case. They are shareholders. They are protected, and anyone who has any kind of office in our organization is really elected, and so we are in turn responsible to our shareholders.
Right. I'm glad to hear that, because one of the thoughts that come to my mind is that nowadays, well, if everything works out and the physician fits right into the corporate structure, then that's no problem. But in case there's some kind of a disagreement and the physician has to be dismissed, and usually it is within the area of either professional misconduct or incompetence. And I would hope that the individual physician doesn't have to go through of a process whereby he thinks that he's the Goliath, the David fighting against the Goliath, the whole corporation. You know, I mean, he have a fair chance of being hurt and things like that. You know, just like any democratic institution, there's a judiciary branch whereby the individual can be, you know, can be evaluated. So I'm glad you say that.
Well, I think in an organization such as ours, and we were talking about teamwork and the necessity of us to work together to accomplish what's best for the patient, one of the very important criteria that we look for in a physician is their ability to function within a team.
Right.
And to function in a somewhat structured kind of environment. There does come times when a person finds that very difficult to do. That it's uncomfortable to function in that kind of environment and they have difficulty functioning with their coworkers. And when that situation arises and their peers judge them not to be suitable, they are indeed told, you know, it's not working out and we need to address it. And given time to try and address the issues and correct them, but sometimes it really doesn't work out. But we do, we're not immune as is anybody else from the legal process. And we could be taken to court and sued for wrongful discharge. And so there's all that kind of protection. But we've really bend over backwards to hopefully be fair in all our interactions.
Especially it's so important because nowadays with the event of the National Data Bank and so forth and so on, I mean, the my wish is that at least the individual physicians who come in and for some reason may have to leave would not be susceptible to any kind of judgmental outcome, you know, that may, you know, I mean, jeopardize his future. You have a question? Great. I've been talking too much. Dr. Wang, you have a...
I have a comment and a thought. In terms of what the ideal physician is, I'm a primary care physician, and maybe a bigger question, not just for the individual, but in general, is the ideal physician more of a primary care physician or a specialist, and do we need more primary care physicians? And my thinking on this is that the primary care physicians are the persons who can take care of the most of the things, a splinter, and help coordinate a patient's care. Mm-hmm. And maybe we need more of these people who know a group of patients very well, mm-hmm. and then can refer to the specialists. And my concern maybe is that there are more specialists now, and maybe too many, that contributes to the competitiveness that there is between doctors. If there's too many specialists and some of them are maybe needing patients and because there's too many of them, and that there's been a de-emphasis because of the concerns about being technically capable, that there have been more, I think, doctors interested in going into specialties. Mm-hmm. But maybe there could be more emphasis on general.
You want to answer? I think she is expressing a concern about the imbalance between specialized care and primary care. There are too many specialists fighting for turf and not enough primary care physicians.
You know, you're touching on the heart of healthcare reform in many ways. And there isn't a physician out there in the traditional structure who doesn't have the same questions or the same fears. And although it may look differently to those outside medicine, those within the house of medicine see tremendous turmoil and tremendous fear over things that any one of us would feel fear about when your livelihood and what you're used to is threatened. I think that the change is necessary, and it's obviously difficult, as change always is. And I think
A change in what direction? More primary care physicians?
The change from the traditional fee-for-service, some people would say sort of a free-for-all kind of medical delivery system, to a more managed care system.
Well, we're addressing another issue here. Because she was talking about the primary care versus specialized care. The common concern nowadays is that we have a surplus of specialists and not enough primary care physicians. Would you comment to that question directly?
Well, I see that they're sort of intertwined, because when you have fee-for-service, you end up with choices to go into subspecialty care. It's considered, to some people, it's more prestigious, not to everyone by any means. There can be better remuneration for specialty services, so we have developed this imbalance. And I think because we have this imbalance is one of the reasons we're moving towards managed care, to balance out the primary care and the specialists. Mm-hmm. I think what you lose potentially there is the motivation in the fee-for-service side is to do things, hopefully to do the appropriate things. But there's certainly evidence that some things are done excessively. Mm-hmm. So as you move towards managing it, managing those resources, one of the first things you need to manage is the primary care balance. And there are fears about what you lose in that process. I don't mm-hmm. think we've gotten there, because I think there's a lot of sort of fat in the system.
Yeah.
But it's certainly possible that as we all get into managed care and prepaid capitated care, that the intense pressure and competition for cost containment mm-hmm. will result in quality changes mm-hmm. that aren't problems now, mm-hmm. but certainly have the serious potential to be problems mm-hmm. in the future. And I think physicians in general are very mindful of the adverse side of healthcare reform. Mm-hmm. And I think a big part of keeping it all in check is the patient or consumer expectations and sort of demands that things are mm-hmm. appropriate.
I guess what she's trying to say, and I kind of agree with her, is that for a lot of minor problems, it is more cost-efficient to have the primary care physicians deal with instead of the specialist. The specialist is very highly trained, and his time and his expertise is very precious and should be reserved for the time when it's needed. What I'm trying to say is that the consumer may not have a better deal going to a specialist for a minor problem. The primary care physician may be as qualified and is more cost efficient.
Yeah, I would take that even further, and I think there's ample demonstration that you don't need a physician necessarily to take care of a lot of minor things. Mm-hmm. You can get just as good, sometimes more timely care from a non-physician.
Right.
So stratifying your resource mix to what you need is important. And you know, I think there should be a role, greater role for non-physicians.
I understand that that's actually being done at Kaiser. You have a lot of physician assistants and so forth.
I very much agree with the point of view about primary care physicians. I think it's only 20% of the graduates from medical school at the present time are choosing to go into primary care. I think the thing that has created that situation is both the financial reward system as it has existed and still to some extent exists. And the fact is that medicine is so complex that it's very difficult for any one physician to become knowledgeable of the whole field. And so for most of us, I used to be a subspecialist, so I understand that it's much more comforting to be an expert in one field than have something that you can say to yourself, I really know this field. I don't have to rely upon anybody else. I can really tell you what's current and what's the best in this field. And it's very reassuring for an individual physician to feel that way. But you can't do that for all of medicine. And so in some respects, the subspecialists are kind of self-protective, you limited your field and you become an expert in that field, but you don't compass everything. So I think all the incentive has been to do that. But in the process, what we've done is we have overemphasized subspecialty work and the attraction of being a primary care physician is gone. And as a result, most people don't go into it. And I think it does contribute to our problem, as Dr. Ting is alluding, of the high cost, is that we basically focus so much on the upper end scale of treatment that we ignore what perhaps we should be doing is more preventive medicine, providing for the 37 million people out there that don't get primary care, don't get prenatal care, and as a result wind up with more expensive kinds of illnesses that we require hospitalization and specialists. Yeah. And we really do need to orient back towards more preventive care, health care maintenance. And I really honestly think that we do need to look at alternatives, even to alternatives to physicians, to be able to provide this sort of care to people, because much of that care conceivably support a paraprofessional, non-physician could very well do that.
Right. You know, one of the reasons that healthcare is so expensive now is that a lot of the healthcare dollars are spent in the last 6 months of life. Well, the problem is you never know when someone's entered their last 6 months of life. You kind of keep doing things. You don't know what the end point is. But to the extent that the end of life, which we don't manage well at all, is in the hands of specialists, it can be an inordinately expensive and not at times it can be a futile way to take care of the patient. To return the care of that patient to the primary care takes tremendous wisdom, cooperation. You want to talk about the ideal physician really needing to come to grips with the family issues and the patient issues, what can be done, and even some societal issues. You want your physician to represent you, but you don't want them to be blind to the fact that you could keep someone alive on all sorts of machines for $1 million, but they're going to die anyway. And to face that full on, to deal with the family's fears, to guide them through a very difficult time is something that is a primary care responsibility that we can all become much better at. Because when it is left in the hands of the specialist, because inevitably it's one organ or another that fails first, the costs are poorly controlled. And I'm not sure that when you deliver that much dollars at that end of the spectrum, inevitably it comes out of not being able to vaccinate children or do some of the other preventative care that's very important.
Yeah. I think we have time for one last question here, and I would like to ask each one of you, the speakers here. It is my belief that one of the deficiency in our system is that the physician, for one reason or another, is not in the front line communicating with the public. And this format is what I have chosen during the past year or so to do, and it has been very precious for me, because I feel that more physicians should participate in the process of communicating with the public through mass media. Have you ever thought of that in Kaiser or in a private setting, that we should have more physicians doing what I'm doing here?
Well, I've often seen, especially if you look at how Hillary Clinton's proceeded with at least initial part of the reform, physicians were seen as sort of part of the problem and not necessarily invited to participate in the initial problem solving. I was glad to see that improved. But I guess to some extent, there is a perception that many physicians they're not a disinterested party, and they represent some of the problems that need to be changed. But I think that if there can be good, articulate spokespeople who really advocate the right kind of health care, I think physicians need to step up to the plate and be counted in exactly the ways that you're mentioning.
Dr. Chow.
I think, frankly, the solution for our national health care situation is really in the hands of the physicians. That if somehow the physicians could organize to cope with the issue, the solution could be resolved. To that extent, I think medicine in general has perhaps not taken the leadership position that it needed to take. And it's for a variety of reasons that has occurred, because we have a diverse interests within the medical profession itself. And probably the profession has not been faced with any kind of common threat to cause it to come together and say, hey, we got to get together and represent the profession and show some leadership. And I would like to see the medical profession do that. I do think we need a more and better state spokesmen that we have. Mm-hmm. I'm not sanguine that we'll get there because we are a very diverse group. We have diverse approaches and interests. But I think it's really necessary because physicians do hold the key to resolving the issue.
I agree with that. Yeah. Anyway, I think we're running out of time. We have had an hour of discussion here, and it goes by so quickly. I'm very grateful to have Dr. Chow and Dr. Ting here with us tonight. You have been very helpful in listening, because we need as many listeners as talkers, isn't it? And hopefully, I believe in the American system, really. And that's why I volunteer for this job, because we need to communicate. You know, and with the modern technology, that is feasible. This is just one small station, but there are many other access stations in your community. Please get the word around. You can become a producer. You can become a host if you want. This is my English is my third language, and I'm trying to make out something that makes sense here. So anyway, I'm just trying to say that by doing these things, hopefully, we will come to a better system, because I think that is the strength of our country, is that we do have an open system. And as individuals, we can participate and make a difference. And I'm very grateful to be in this position of having all of you to be guests here at our studio tonight. And our show is America's Healthcare Crisis. So long, until next time. Thank you for watching. Good night.